motion to approve the agenda? Need a motion to approve? Are you, for those who are ready, can you hear us? All right, so I have a first and a second for approval of the agenda. I'll call for the vote, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Motion carries unanimously.
All right, for item 5.1, public comment, do we have any public comments on item 6.1?
Yes, we do, Todd. Okay, I'm going to call three people up at a time. So I have Carolyn West, Elizabeth Thorne, and Radhika Kirsten.
Okay, I'm sorry. Hello, my name is Elizabeth Thorne. I'm one of your faithful and hardworking school nurses. I'm really happy to see all of you guys in person. I really am. So I'm going to make this quick. You know what we're talking about today. There's a lovely presentation that Clint's going to give us later. I'm going to address a couple of slides, so you may not know what I'm going to talk about, but I'm going to mention it anyway. One of the issues about how to spend this money under health and safety preparedness is, according to what has been decided so far, is purchasing cleaning and sanitation supplies, which I think we already have. And, of course, we always need more. And training professional development on minimizing the spread of infectious diseases, which I know we spend a lot of time on. What I'd like to address is the health office needs at all of the school sites. The health offices, many of them in the new locations, don't even have sinks, do not have accessible bathrooms. Of the existing health offices that are there, if we are going to be moving back to them, and I'm not sure if we will, probably not this school year, I understand, they are very, very small. At Radcliffe, even the new health office is very, very small, to the point where the dividers, when they are up to provide distance, the health clerk cannot keep her eyes on the students at all, cannot see them at all. So she has to keep if there were a student that were sick and symptomatic, which we will get, she has to keep the healthy student outside if they have just complained of a stomachache, outside the door. And how is that going to work in the wintertime? So that's one issue. The other issue is the nurses themselves. We have a staff of 10 currently. I know that we have more than that, but we have 10 who are handling schools. We have no sub-plan. What happens when a nurse goes out sick and we have a nurse who's pregnant? She's going to go out on family leave. How are we going to cover her? Last year, when we lost the nurse in September and that position did not get filled until February, those schools were put on the existing schools, on the existing school nurses. Well, with COVID tracing, which we are going to continue to do, we did not have the time for that. So, I would like to have those points also addressed with this funding that you have. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Carolyn West, and I'm also one of your school nurses. Not to replicate everything that Elizabeth was just saying, but I agree, I feel very strongly. We do have positions that are open right now. We have been told there's going to be a set of school nurse position. There's nothing documented about that. We just told my mother that existed. Right now, Elizabeth said we do have one nurse that's expecting. At least 4 out of 10 of us are in 55. I work in 3 at the school year, and I'm still recovering. And so there's still a lot going on. It's just trying to get school year last year. I have all the health assistants out at the same time. For one reason or another, usually COVID-related. And I'm just worried for us to be able to make a concerted effort with actually having to take a gap at school, but we don't have the staff to support that as far as we have to focus. Obviously, cleaning bodies is important in training, but we've been doing a lot of that already. We need the bodies more. I have 5 schools this school year, two of my schools don't even have health offices. In fact, we did a specific quarters of the multi-purpose room called out health office. So I don't think we're completely ready and we'll stop for the patient to be ready. I think that I can do this.
Good evening, President Holm, Board of Trustees, Dr. Rodriguez. I think you all know who I am, but I'm Rebecca Gerdman. I was the grievance officer for PBFT, and I will now be stepping into the role of chief negotiator for the upcoming year. So there's a couple things I want to address about the presentation this evening in regards to the use of funding that the district is receiving, which in addition to the ESSER is close to $100 million in COVID funding. So the first area is in our presentation it says that the district has engaged in meaningful consultation with specified stakeholders. So currently the district has community conversations, virtual town halls, and surveys. And with a student population of approximately 19,000, we have 688 responses to the survey, and an in-person town hall that was held during the summer for 1 hour in English and 1 hour in Spanish. So we do not believe that that meets the criteria of meaningful consultation with stakeholders, nor do we believe that that is enough input to make a final vote on use of this funding. We are pleased to see in the OCAP the additional resources that the district plans to provide, such as the temporary additional counseling personnel, additional intervention staffing, special education supports, such as the full-time resource teacher at each elementary site. However, those services can only be provided if we can hire staff to do that. Right now, the starting salary for a full-time teacher is $46,666. As of 5:15 this afternoon, PBSD had 46 certificated job postings for a total of 127 vacancies listed on entering. I know we cannot control the housing market in this area, but our members cannot afford to live here on those salaries. Whereas I am Rebecca. Thank you. We look forward to working together to come to this mission.
I have Daniel Murphy, Eduardo, and Bill Beecher.
I'm Board of Trustees. This is my first time ever speaking before a board meeting. I've been in education since 1983. I've been a school psychologist since 1990. I've worked throughout California and across the world. Now, with our obvious issue at hand with ESSER funding, there are huge needs where school psychologists can really help to address the elevated anxiety of parents, students, teachers, even administrators. School psychologists are highly trained in terms of, I'm going to take my mask, I've been double vaccinated. There's so much that school psychologists can do to help. And there's a real need in our district for even more school psychologists than we currently have. The National Association of School Psychologists recommends one school psychologist for 500 to 700 general education children. Given that suggested formula, we should have about 38 school psychologists in this district to address needs even before the pandemic. But the pandemic is really going to push. I am concerned about our need for preventing suicide, for prevention, for intervention, for postvention, but also just to help students learn better, to teach targeted stress management, anxiety management. I'm probably going through about 2 minutes right now.
30.
I have 30 more seconds. I am just so glad that you're all here listening to these comments. And I know that the nurses come as hard are definitely sincere and well-founded. We all work extremely hard. I'm looking forward to starting the new year in just 2 weeks, but I think that we need to have more hires for mental health and for school psychology in particular. And this is a long-term objective for the school psychology department because we work so hard and we know the students and their families are very well. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day.
I just want to quickly remind everyone that the county basically provides the recommendations for masking indoors for all people regardless of immunization status. So just as a reminder, that is the county recommendation.
Good evening, everyone. I'm going to say, I'm going to say, thank you for being here in Denmark. I just got reminded my kid just went 20 years here and recently my daughter just graduated from home. So I've been working on that for now 20 years as a parent and raising kids here in London. So, but I wanted to consider, waiting for your infrastructure. Because even though this is one of the, I think premier schools, there's some really rundown schools. Our bathroom space or just the playground just here are needed updating. So just wanting you to consider as an advocate for this community, those things. Thank you.
Good evening. I'd like to amend my comments at the previous meeting that the money should be spent on critical issues, and if you add up what the CBO's going to show, it exceeds the amount of money we have. My amendment is that we should reward some of our employees by giving them $1,000 each for those who have gotten their shots. If they haven't gotten their shots, I don't believe in rewarding bad behavior. And if you see the latest statistics, those going into the hospital and those that are dying, 99% plus are those that haven't been vaccinated. So don't reward people who didn't get their shots. Now, when you look at the critical facilities needs, if you don't fix the buildings, I don't care how many other people you add, nurses, psychologists, et cetera, you gotta close schools. And we have some very bad stuff that needs to be repaired. You'll see that in the presentation shortly. And then for Trustee Dodge, you ran on replacing Willie Hero and his old ideas. Your involvement in two Brown Act violations and recent police charges are not the new ideas
please
that we have hoped for.
Your comments to the agenda.
Thank you. Please respond.
Okay, next speakers, Doris, Edith Ruiz, and Marie.
Good afternoon. I feel like this is a speed dating task here. District school psychologists need doable caseload assignments in order to meet the growing learning and mental health needs of our students and their families. Our national organization recommends 500 and 700 general students per school psychologist. In PBUSD, our average ratio is about 1,200 to 1,400 students per school psychologist. That, did you know that school psychologists are trained and legally qualified to provide mental health services? School psychologists, we take courses in behavior analysis, human and child development, research, ethics, and law. We take courses in school systems to provide consultation, academic interventions, progress monitoring. We take courses in mental health therapy, solution focus, and cognitive therapy, crisis intervention, crisis intervention, and crisis solutions. And of course, assessments. We're the only district employees with credentials and training to administer, analyze, and interpret intelligence tests, along with academic, perceptual, and social emotional measures. So be proactive. Hire at least 2 new additional school psychologists for the 2021-22 school year so we can work towards a ratio toward our professional organization. As school psychologists transition to a role beyond testing for special education, we need to work in collaboration with our general ed colleagues to work toward that common goal of decreasing discipline actions, increasing attendance, improving academic attainments, and to support and provide training to our teachers, administrators, and parents. So anyone like my name and number, we can turn back to work as a psychologist on Monday, August 2nd. Thank you for your time.
Good evening, my name is Leah Cruz. I am a lucky parent of students that have attended Landmark State High School, Landmark Elementary, Lakeview, and Watson High, and soon to have a college student that is prepared for this. I'm speaking today as a parent and as a teacher on the ESSER funds that are coming into our district, and how can we best use them to help our students succeed in getting college and career ready. One thing that I want to point out is no coordination classes. This year, here at Landmark, I got to witness my children have also been participants of coordination classes. It's really hard on the students and on the teachers. So please, would be better to have some other classes instead of combos whenever we have the facilities at the schools. We also need qualified teachers compensated for their time and their qualifications. Cost of living keeps going up in this county. This, pay them what they're worth. Counselors, nurses, psychologists at every school. Nurses save lives. This happens at every school, so the psychologists and counselors. Safety, let's make sure our schools are safe. Watson High has a homeless shelter right next door. Let's keep an eye on that. Parent outreach, I didn't think that there was enough of it done for us to vote on the ESSER funds for this meeting. As an educator, what do we want? I'm not a legal educator. Up until recently, I never got really got trained on anything that was related to bilingual education, I think. So we need more support for training. As an educator, we also need a cost of living. Please, no more combination classes. As a mentor teacher, I want to make sure that the students that I'm trained to become teachers stay in our district. I have been training teachers for the last 18 years. Maybe one is hired by a district or two because they've been hired in Salinas or San Jose, somewhere else. So let's train them so they stay here or they want to work in our district. Thank you so much for your time.
Good evening, everybody. I already spoke at last month's board meeting, as well as emailed all of the trustees regarding how we are training school psychologists to support students at all levels of multi-care systems of supports. And I also echoed the sentiment shared by my colleagues, Flores and Danny. What I'd like to stress this evening is this: what you do and don't do with the ESSER funding is pivotal to our students' success. I do not envy the person responsible for balancing the district's checkbook. I know that is a hard job. I can't even imagine. But when you think about what we can afford to do or not do, ask yourselves this: can we take chances with our students' mental health needs? Currently, the school psychologists are not staffed appropriately, as mentioned by my colleagues already. We would need to hire many school psychologists just to meet that recommendation. However, we will take whatever you give us. We are willing to come to work every day and meet with the most vulnerable students and try to help them and our community, including their families. But we need you guys to meet us halfway. We need to be appropriately staffed. That is a basic minimum recommendation requirement, and I don't know why we have to come and plead for that. It seems that as the people responsible for making these decisions and knowing what's been going on in our community, in our nation, it is important to recognize that we can even begin to conceive what we are going to be facing the first day, the first month, and for the rest of this school year. The learning loss, the mental health needs, what's happening in our students' homes, they all need qualified and trained people to meet them at every level. That's from the basic tier one, the students who may be
clear at time.
Thank you for listening. I will also follow up with another email. Thank you.
Are there any other further comments?
There are no more public comments.
All right, so we will move on to item 6.1, our elementary secondary education emergency relief plan. Report
by Dr. Michelle
Rodriguez, our superintendent of schools, and
Tim
Rucker, our chief business officer.
Yes, thank you so much. So I just want to, I'm going to send it off with Clint too, and I just wanted to give all of business services, Clint specifically, and then also our facilities department, a lot of accolades for preparing for this. You'll see within this next couple of minutes, what you'll see is they literally went site by site to identify what were some of the urgent needs. And then also we're looking at how can we extend the staffing that we have already submitted through other funding, such as the Extended Learning Opportunities Grant, to continue that funding. Because what we know is this is all one-time funds. And so we do need to be very purposeful and strategic on how we use it so that we can sustain the staffing that we have put in place. And so, take it away.
Thank you, President Holmes, Board of Trustees, and Dr. Rodriguez, and thank you for the community for coming out today. Really appreciate it. This is very important to have a discussion on how we will spend the elementary secondary school's emergency relief budget. So, for everyone who believes already that's a mouthful, I'm going to continue to refer to it as ESSER. So specifically tonight, we're talking about ESSER 2 and ESSER 3, which I'm going to do the next slide as to where those funds came from. Let's see if we get this work for this time.
No.
Ooh, it does work. All right. Love it. Okay, so what is the ESSER funding? So again, Elementary Secondary Schools Emergency Relief is what California calls it for ourselves, or how our state decided to divvy out those funds. They actually came from two federal acts. So ESSER 2 came from the Coronavirus Response and Relief Supplemental Appropriations, so that's CRRSA, so different from CARES Act, which gave us the CARES funding early on. The second set of, or really third set of ESSER 3 came from the American Rescue Plan, which was most recently done by President Biden. So two sets of money that come from two federal acts that actually are then dispersed by state. We have, for our school district specifically, we received $52.76 million in ESSER 2 and 3 funding. That's $16 million for ESSER 2 and $36.69 million for ESSER 3. So again, those funding sources coming from the state, but really originating at that federal level. So what are the requirements? As you heard some of the speakers talk about, we've heard Dr. Rodriguez speak to it, I've spoken to it as in some of my budget presentations. Any dollars really we normally see from the federal government come with strings attached, so to speak. They come with certain requirements that we need to spend them on. Most of you are familiar with Title I funding, again, federal funding that has very specific requirements. So ESSER funding does have some specific requirements. We tried to narrow those down to those seven kind of main key points that are in that ESSER Act. Health and safety, preparedness, response, and training. So as you heard Elizabeth Thorne speak to, that does include personal protective equipment, supplies for cleaning and disinfecting, training for to mitigate the spread of infectious disease. Doesn't mean that's all it's useful. Those are some of the examples of what would fit into that health and safety, preparedness, response, and training. We also have supports for vulnerable population. So again, this is our English learners, our low income, our foster youth, our homeless. These are the students that really need those additional supports. A lot of times I'm asked why Pajaro Valley Unified School District receives so much funding versus these other districts that don't receive the same amount of funding versus our size. It's because we are supporting a lot of these vulnerable populations. 80% of our students fall into that unduplicated account to get those, the free and reduced, the low income. As I mentioned, those are really one of the big pushes on that sort of where that funding needs to go is towards those students who really need those extra support. So as we look at the amount that Pajaro Valley Unified School District receives, we also have to look at the students we serve. And those students do need those supports that that money can go towards. We also have purchase and access to educational technology. Oh, I'm sorry, for vulnerable populations, those are things like giving them access to EAOP, our early academic outreach program. It's giving them additional tutoring supports. It's giving them on-site supports through staffing. It's really trying to provide them with additional support to help them kind of close that achievement gap. Purchase and access to educational technology. This would be things like access to programs, which we've already done a lot of through our CARES Act funding. It's also access to technology for assistive devices, for additional digital technology. That would be fit in that educational technology section. Mental health services and supports. Thank you to the nurses and neuropsychologists who spoke about that. I think myself and Dr. Rodriguez have this as very high as one of the priorities. We do see the need for mental health supports for our students. This includes anything from hiring additional social-emotional counselors, supporting the social-emotional counselors that we did hire with the ELL funds, looking at additional supports through potentially PBPSA, anything to provide our students with more supports and mental health services and supports. We also have summer learning and supplemental after-school programs. As you all know, our Expanded Learning Opportunities Grant, that's ELL, so in case I go back to using acronyms, That grant that we filled out in the plan we have actually did provide a more robust summer school for 21-22, which we are coming up on, and the year we just finished. This would actually allow us to potentially do a third iteration of a more robust summer school as the ESSER funds do go through 2024. So that could be one use of that. Address learning loss amongst students. So another one of the big categories for ESSER funding is looking at the learning loss from distance learning. So this would be more intensive close achievement gap, looking at more intensive requirements for supporting students with learning loss, looking at additional supports through community partners. We have Life Lab, we have the Latino Youth Film Festival, we have a lot of different LC Stamma. So we have a lot of partners that we can work with to kind of help with that as well. And then school facilities repairs and improvements. You heard a few talk about that. We definitely looked at that as one of the big key pieces of ESSER because, as Bill, I think, kind of put pretty succinctly, without our facilities, we don't have a place to house our students. So those are kind of the big seven pots of money that ESSER falls into. Again, the examples I use are some examples of what would fall into those pots of money. So thinking about timelines, as I kind of mentioned prior, the Expanded Learning Opportunities Grant that we approved back in May 26th, I believe, that funding only takes us through August 30th of 2022. So we received about $15.06 million in Expanded Learning Opportunities Grant money. Again, we put some of that towards staffing, which at the time the board had expressed, we don't want to see this staffing last only 1 year. But we knew that $15 million was only 1 year money. So as much as we would have liked to spread it out over multiple years, state said, nope, you have to use it by August 30th, 2022, or we take it. So we did look at some things we could do as one-time supports for students, but we also did things like hiring an additional 32 instructional aides, adding 16 intervention teachers for our elementary sites. Those are ongoing costs. So utilizing ESSER, which brings me to the next point, we can actually extend some of those opportunities for multiple years because ESSER 2, you'll see the funding actually goes through 2023 and ESSER 3 goes through 2024. So again, being creative with those ESSER funds and realizing we have received the money, yes, it was allocated to us, it's supposed to actually last us through 2024. So again, that $52.76 million sounds like a lot of money. It's not quite as much when you realize that's really 2 to 3 years worth of expenditures. So what have we done so far for stakeholder input? So we did do an asset 2 and 3 survey. We made it available on July 6th. We had responses on July 16th. Now we have about 15 or so more responses. All of the data stays about the same in terms of where the voting has gone. We have 390 parents and guardians and students, 29 community members, and 270 staff members. So we get a good amount of staff responding, which is nice to see. We also have town hall meetings. We have them on Wednesday, July 4th. So we have them at 5:30 p.m. we did our English one, and at 6:30 we did do our Spanish. So during the town hall, Dr. Rodriguez and myself, we had actually everyone who was attending give input as to what they would like to see that money spent on. What kind of words pop into their mind? Because sometimes it's hard to put things into a category, but you know exactly what you want. And what we saw a lot of was kind of what the survey really showed us. A lot of social-emotional supports, closing the learning gap, social-emotional needs. Again, you see a lot of learning support in there, capital improvements. We really saw a lot focused on our students and focused on their mental health and their success. And I think that's exactly what we want to see as we're going through these surveys. And again, we also did one in Spanish, and we saw some similar themes along with what we saw during the English channel. So it was great to see both participations during that day. So I'm going to try to go somewhat quickly so I don't talk forever. I know sometimes I can talk forever, so we'll keep it somewhat short. But I do want to look at kind of what did we see from the survey. So again, for mental health services and supports, and you'll see a theme here, which is I am going to actually show the responses in from kind of descending order of what got the most 10 votes kind of going downward. So the biggest support we saw was for mental health services and supports. So again, speaking to what that could be, additional social emotional counselors, expanded PBPSA support, family wellness and engagement centers. So all things that we know we've heard from the board, these are interests that we have in the extended learning plan, and something that utilizing these ESSER $2 and $3, we can absolutely continue for multiple years. Next up is we saw supports for vulnerable populations, again, such as our English learners and low-income students. And these examples, again, student outreach, access to our early academic outreach program, the AOP, additional special education supports, and additional general education supports. Again, another high-ranking one, we have 33 of the 31 individuals, both that has a number 10 on their choice. And again, these are the things we like to see in these surveys. It's really putting our students first, showing that we understand that the pandemic has caused a lot of harm to our students, not just in terms of educationally, but mental health. We are looking at all of these types of supports. And number 3 was school facilities. So again, as you saw in those work clouds, kind of the top 3 survey responses, we saw mimic what we saw in those work clouds. We see that school facilities repairs and improvements are important to our staff, our community, and our stakeholders. Window replacements, HVAC improvements, repairing damaged roofing. Again, ESSER allows us to utilize funding on anything that would provide health and safety for our students, especially during COVID times. Well, as all of you know, trying to maintain a clean classroom and air quality when you have damaged roofing is nearly impossible. So we do, again, I want to clarify a little bit. A lot of times people think, well, you have damaged roofing, so are roofs constantly leaking? No. But we do have maintenance spending a lot of time repairing roofing and making sure they're maintained. Number 4 was addressing learning loss among students. So again, administering high quality assessments, improving student engagement, learning hubs, tutoring supports, and then our community partners, as I had mentioned. So again, some really great ideas that we've come up with that we can utilize as ESSER funding for, and you can see again the kind of community support behind these ideas. Summer learning and after school supplemental programs. Again, this would be focusing really not this school year, but the following school year is doing another expanded summer school as we're kind of in right now. Right now we're doing our second session of summer school. We're planning on using ELO funds for that next year, because again, those go through August. And then once we come to 22-23, those ELO funds run out. So we could utilize ESSER funds to kind of expand summer school or do an expanded intersession. Health and safety preparedness, response, and training. So, again, as I mentioned, purchasing, cleaning, and sanitation supplies, training, and professional development on minimizing the spread of infectious disease. I'd like to speak briefly to what Elizabeth Thorne said, I totally agree. When you look at things like health offices, absolutely money can be allocated towards those trying to support students in that way. So again, the examples are not inclusive of everything that this money can spend on, but it's trying to keep within those buckets of money and kind of those themes. Purchase and access to educational technology. So again, access to assistive technology, digital programs, learning tabs. We saw often have 181 votes at number 10. So again, we do have a second presentation, which I'll be moving on to, which will talk about really the facilities piece and what that's going to look like. But before I move on to that, I did want to see if there's any quick questions or clarification I need to make on this slide. But if not, I can move on and we can do it then.
Yeah, I have a question. So we talked about our health center, so we have EA model opening the health center, hopefully December, correct?
The family needs to
get a little bit more. Now, when we talked about, like, did we have a plan to hire a psychologist, another school psychologist?
We have not talked about increasing school psychologists at this point. We have been focusing on social emotional counselors, mental health clinicians. We will be hiring an additional nurse for the wellness center.
That's something we can present. Thank you. Any other questions?
I have a question, but I'll wait until you.
Oh yeah, perfect. Again, I just needed a breather for a quick second. So thank you, Trustee Shocker, for giving me that quick breather.
As far as the new position that we approved, I'm assuming that when we fly these positions, I'm assuming that we are flying them as temporary positions through 2024. Correct?
Yes.
I just want to make sure that they understand that it could be temporary. I know that as a district, we're going to try our best to make sure that it becomes permanent, but that's something that we cannot promise at this point in time. And then as far as the extended summer, this was a program that was not accessible to all students. Is that correct?
No, it should have been accessible to all students the second session of summer school.
Any student who applied or did the application by the deadline, did go in. We do have a waiting list of some students who applied after the fact, and in some cases we were able to allocate more staff and get more staff, and in some cases we weren't. But most students, we have hundreds of students right now that are doing second session as we speak. There are some students, we had some schools that had a pretty large influx as if the program was starting, and at that point we had already staffed, and we have to maintain a particular staffing. So,
okay. Thank you. Those are my questions for now. Thank you.
I just want to make sure if there's any questions since we won't. We're going to be moving away from these slides, but I can always go back at them.
I have a couple of questions.
Go ahead. I had a couple of questions about the surveys.
Mm-hmm.
Was there, do you have any information about the characteristics of the respondents? So, like, was there, like, people who tended to put items at high priority, if they consistently put things at high priority? Or was there differentiation? Were individuals prioritizing what they felt was the most important?
Yeah, so the, again, about 705 that we had as I looked this morning, there was about 47 where individuals put the majority at 10. But other than that, the results were roughly, again, just looking at mathematically, about a 6.7, 6.8 in terms of the average rating of a. So there was definitely variation where we had a lot of individuals who were putting things at 10 and certain things at 1 or 2 or 3. So there was definitely variation in what they were looking for.
And in terms of, because I know that getting respondents to surveys, is always a challenge anyway. How are our numbers compared to other surveys?
Well, too, I just wanted to note that we did capitalize also on the thought exchange that we did. So the thought exchange would help land in this. But what we did to ensure that we had as much outreach as possible is we did make sure that media covered our town hall, which did result in us having some additional responses from that. I will say that for a survey that is funding related, we did fairly well. So for us, about 1,000 is good for us. We've had better responses in surveys around COVID because I think when it's health related, we see many more responses. So our COVID surveys, we generally have many more. We were in about 3,000 generally in health and safety, but we feel that just a combination between the thought exchanges. So if you actually look at the trends between the thought exchange, the town halls, and the Google survey that we're speaking of, they're very congruent. So it is very similar across the board. And with the previous thought exchange, we also did work with school site councils, DLAC, and also our migrant parent group, and the trends are very similar. I will say it was interesting though at the in kind of thought with the word cloud, especially if you read in Spanish, the Spanish group from the town hall focused much more on facilities and safety than the English group did. They spoke much more to make sure that the buildings are clean, that they're kept up. They spoke about cleanliness of improving bathrooms and all of that. We did much further outreach than any other school district that I'm aware of. What is positive is that we're seeing an alignment from all the different groups.
Thank you.
Come
at the end if you'd rather,
or
I don't know if you still need a little break.
No, I'm happy. If you're happy to wait for the end, I'm happy to go to the presentation if you'd like to make it.
Okay, I think I will.
Okay.
But I did want to come back to the comments about the survey and facilitations too.
Thank you. Okay, so part two of our school facilities improvement. So to echo what Dr. Rodriguez said, I do not do this alone. I do like doing my presentations alone because I'm long enough to present them, but I do get a lot of support in terms of the information and really the boots on the ground work. So I'd like to thank Ryan Roth and Harry Webb, our director of AIDS, senior project manager. Both of them did a lot of work on our facilities. I'd also like, since I have a moment, to give a shout out to our director of fiscal services, Colleen Mugling. For those who do not know her, she a lot of the time is the one who is cracking the numbers late at night to make sure that our budget is really staying sustainable. So I can't take all the credit for it. She is a wonderful person to have beside me. So. Anyway, ESSER 2, our school facility improvements. So what we looked at in this is really what were our goals. So what did we look at? We looked at our top priorities for each site. So what you'll see in this presentation along with the additional documentation that was provided on board docs is the priorities for each site. How did we identify these priorities? I will get to that. And then what we started to do is identify common themes. So what did we see throughout the district that were common at each site that we could say, this is one of the really big needs or this. So we identified those common themes. We're going to recommend our allocation for ESSER funding. So this will tie to that first slide as well. And then kind of improvement goals for our facilities is improve the facilities for our students. That's really what it comes down to. That's why we're all here. And again, it's really trying to bring it back to our students. So kind of talking about our first common theme we saw was fire alarms. So I want to again dispel any concerns that we don't have working fire alarms. We absolutely have working fire alarms. However, we do have old failing systems where the wiring is causing us, not necessarily false alarms going off, but troubles, warnings on the fire alarm devices. So this happens from wires that aren't very deep enough. when you get moisture in the air or heavy rains, they end up not functioning, and you end up getting trouble, false alarm, but maintenance has to go out and look at and identify. So again, it's wasting staff time and resources. We also have UPSA requirements. Those requirements are not going to require a voice over IP system. So those require effectively what we use for internet, right? A cap file cable. They're no longer wired in the traditional way. They're wired through an Ethernet port, and they do have, you know, a nicer interactive panel that old systems do not have. We also have a few sites that still have Simplex fire alarm systems. So what that is a proprietary system. So actually our own staff can't work on those systems because they are not certified as Simplex technicians. So you have a system that our own staff can't go and support, and the closest person who can actually support it, I believe, is in Livermore. Yeah, so not ideal. And so again, you can see the sites that have some of these problems that you'll see during this presentation. Boilers. So we have many outdated units. A lot of these end up causing us problems with heating in our classrooms. They end up costing us a lot more in terms of what they cost to run and to actually heat a building. We have large inefficient boilers in some sites. Some of these sites, if a boiler goes down, it actually results in about 30 to 35 classrooms going down in terms of heat. So again, needing to replace some of those old boilers. We also have some old inactive units. So really a long time ago, but looking back at some of the units that are still in our schools that have never been renewed. So they're not actually being used, but they're still in our schools taking up space. The reason we haven't removed them back when they first became inactive was, look, it's a lot of work really and a lot of money to remove them. You have to do an inspection for mold, and then if you find mold or asbestos, you have to do abatement. So there's a lot of work that goes into actually removing just the whole unit. So that's another problem we see, and again, you can see at these sites. And again, just as a reminder, this doesn't mean that these are the only sites that have this issue. These are the ones where it's really becoming a priority for us to fix. And again, these priorities are looking at items that, as we continue to not fix or put money towards actually replacing, we're spending more and more manpower and time to just keep doing them. So really we're wasting a lot of manpower resources on things that we need to do with us. Window replacement. So we have a few sites, and again, you'll see only two are listed. These are the ones that really have those big priority, where they still have their original windows from when the school was first built. So through time, through weather, these windows no longer open. They are rusted shut, or the device on them just will no longer operate. They're also very low energy efficient windows. A lot of them are single pane windows. So you see that specifically at Alianza Woods here. We also see a lot of coastal environmental damage. So a lot of times we look at our facilities and people say, wow, you know, your facilities have a lot of problems that other schools, districts, or other sites don't have. We have a lot of damage that comes from living by our beautiful coast. So we see a lot of siding damage through moisture, through the air that we have in this area. We see dry rot, and we also see tunnel. So again, we see a lot of damage that is caused really from living where we live. So again, the pluses and the minuses of being here. And then HVAC, furnace ducting and replacement. So a lot of you are probably thinking, didn't we spend a lot of money and repairs on HVAC replacement? We did. We spent quite a bit. We replaced many of our portable units, but we have a lot of large HVAC units on our rooftops that really need to be replaced. We also have furnaces, again, going back to, as I spoke to with the boilers, same idea where we just have furnaces that are not efficient, they aren't running well. When they go down, their parts are getting older and older, where it's harder to find the parts to fix some of these furnaces, and then duct replacement for our HVAC as well. So again, we did replace a lot of our bar units, which are the units that go on the outside of a portable, but in terms of the actual duct replacement for some of our larger buildings, we did not get that with the CARES Fund. And then roofing. So again, roofing is a really big one you'll see for a lot of sites, and you'll also see that it comes with a very hefty dollar amount. That's because a lot of the roofing damages we have requires us to replace entire roofs. Again, I don't want you to think that we have leaking roofs. Gary's team does a fantastic job of going through each year, patching any that we do find problems with. But as we have those heavy rains from those El Nino winters, when we have those really hard storms, we do start to see more and more damage and having to, again, spend more and more time repairing them. We also see aging, dry rot, gutters that need to be replaced. So roofing, you can see, has quite a few sites on there. It is one of the biggest concerns we have, because again, as I spoke to earlier, if we're looking at cleaning air in classrooms and we're trying to keep students safe, roofing is something that we really need to look at, because while right now Gary and his team are doing a fantastic job of keeping our students safe and repairing the roofs, there really needs to be some major work done. That really is not something that maintenance handles, it's something we need to replace. So how do we determine these priorities? You may look and say, when I look at some of those priorities and I'm looking at the sites, I'm looking at the sites that I serve as a board member, I didn't see X, Y, or Z for my site. So really, they were reviewed by maintenance and facilities, so again, by Gary and by Ryan. They also aligned with our health and safety guidelines, so we looked at ESSA, looked at what we were trying to accomplish, also looking at CDPH, what were they asking us to do for this upcoming year. We also looked at investments that are going to save ongoing costs. One of the things we're trying to do with one-time money always is, how do you help one-time money become ongoing money? Typically, you do that by investing in facilities. If we're spending less to repair the facilities, that gives us more money to kind of go back to maintaining the facilities that do have working boilers or do have working HVAC, and we have the time and the manpower to put on those projects rather than trying to repair something that is going to continue to fail. It's really looking at those sites that have those chronic problems, where it's continually happening. We also looked at ongoing site concerns. Gary looked through our work order system, looked at what had sites reported in the past, but this is the problem. This is what we need. Where have we continually been going back out to and saying, we fixed the roof over at Laptop Junior, and then we did it again. So things like that to really see where do we need to invest money to kind of save us on that, save us on the employee side. And then we also reviewed our preliminary master plan. As many of you know, we did do some work with Maddie to build a facilities master plan, which involved walking sites, looking at what the big concerns were, working with the principals to address the needs of their sites. Ryan looked at a lot of those walks, so through his experience, he was able to go back and say, when we walked that class junior, this is what we saw. When we walked Calabasas, this is what we saw. So that's kind of how these priorities were determined. So again, what have we already done? So as I mentioned before, you might ask, well, didn't we do a lot of HVAC work already? Absolutely. We installed 95 new HVAC units utilizing CARES money. It was about $800,000 in units. We removed old HVAC units and installed fully brand new HVAC rooftop units. We installed 55 new furnaces, and we also completed 10 of our Informacast clock bell paging systems. So those are the paging systems to be able to alert schools, be able to send out moving towards sending out district-wide messages as well. So we were able to do that with our CARES funding. And then many of you who are here and have been here for a long time know, didn't get a lot of bond funding that should have repaired a lot of these problems and went towards all these problems. Absolutely. We actually completed 10 full roofing replacements at 10 of our sites. So we had 10 sites that had full roofing replacements done. You can see Alianza Charter, Aptos High School, Pajaro Middle, again, amongst others. We also completed partial roofings at 10 sites. So again, where we went in and we said, here's the really damaged roofing that we need to look at, we need to repair, we also did that. And then using Measure L and bond funding, and as well as money that was committed by the board. The board actually did a resolution to commit funds to do some of these roofing projects as well. We also completed 20 Informacast clock bell paging systems. So almost all of our site time, I think we're about four shy, Dan would correct me if he was here, but I believe it's four, all now have this brand new system. And so, again, to be clear, every site does have a paging system. They just do not have the new Informacast paging system. So again, with our CARES money and Measure L, we were really focusing on the sites that have failing systems, not necessarily improving systems that were already working. So that brings us to what do we need? So when we're talking about facilities, as many of you know who were here or worked in the district, roughly $300 million was identified in repairs when we first started our review for our Measure L bond. We received $150 million in Measure L funding. This was 10 years ago. So 10 years ago, we had $150 million in projects that weren't going to be funded. It's now been 10 years. And facilities do not grow better over time. So that is, we have $150 million we did not get 10 years ago, as well as 10 years of damages and just aging of our facilities. Currently, through working with maintenance and facilities, we estimate there's about $93 million in what we consider that priority projects. So those projects we want to get done as soon as possible because they really will help provide health and safety for our students, as well as save us money in the long run. And as I mentioned before, the district has $52.76 million in SR2 and SR3 funding. We don't need to do mathematicians to see that those numbers don't match up. And we clearly have a lot more facilities work that needs to be done than we do SR2 and SR3 funding, as well as we need to utilize some of that SR2 and SR3 funding for those supports you saw our community reach out about those social emotional supports, as well as those low-income students needing additional supports. So I will try and go briefly through these because I believe the discussion will be more important than necessarily spending too much time on each one of these schools and if everyone wants to hear me talk for an hour. So all the odds that we identified, fire alarm, window replacement, the field has been flooding, and it just gives you a little description kind of view. I'll leave the slides up for a bit and I'll talk briefly about this so that if you have questions or you want to kind of review them, you have time to take notes. Mesquite Elementary School, we saw again fire alarm, siding the NPR portables, again that weather from that environmental coastal damage, and then roofing throughout the site. So again, going back to that roofing. You can see the estimate for Mesquite is anywhere from $2.5 to $4.5 million. I know when I was working with Dr. Rodriguez, we looked at it and she goes, is that a 10-12? Because that's a big jump. And I said, well, no, the problem is, for those of you who know, have done any home improvements, your $2,000 project quickly becomes a $10,000 project once you finally say, hey, I pulled up those boards and oh, look what I need to do underneath. So same kind of thing happens as we're looking at our roofing. Sometimes it's a very easy, easy being it's a more simple fix, and sometimes it's much more complicated. Sometimes you have volume beams, sometimes you really do have to do a lot more work once you kind of pull up that. And so we'll look at work for HVAC, fire alarm, clock bell paging systems. They are one of the few sites that are remaining that need a brand new system. Aptos High, the boilers at Aptos High, the fire alarm, and then a gas line replacement. For those of you who know, we've had trouble with Aptos High and that gas line. Again, that quote is because, as we kind of saw at Hall District, sometimes it's an easy fix, and sometimes you have to go to step two, step three, step four to actually fix some of these problems. So again, nothing to be concerned about if the gas is leaking at Aptos and our students are in danger, but it is something that over time, it will become a problem.
Second question. We have a solar array at Aptos High. Why do we need a gas line there?
I would guess it's for the boilers, but Gary could probably help me with that.
The boilers.
Boilers are like an obsolete type of technology.
Yeah.
Why are we even repairing
or replacing boilers? Why can't we use some kind of HVAC with our solar? Gary, you want to help with the boilers? The boilers actually are just old and inefficient, mostly. You're going to go from about a 60 to 70% efficient boiler to a boiler that's 90-95% efficient, which gives you about anywhere from a 5 to 7 year payback for return on investment. So after that point, all the savings that you're going to realize with gas are actually become real at that point.
Do you get my question though? Why can't you just use a different type of HVAC system?
You do have the solar there, but you don't have the capacity to do electric heat. Boilers are still the most efficient way to heat a building.
Okay. Because $1.5 million is a lot of money to lay a gas line, a brand new gas line, when there's already one existing there. I just don't understand, I guess, why it would be that much. And why is it even happening? The other thing is, you know, Aptos High is really hot. There are classrooms that, like, people are bringing their fans up to it and air conditioning for years.
That's a good question. We probably should look at it a little more closely. It's worth the second look, for sure. I know from 30 years of experience that gas is the most efficient way to heat.
Okay.
Electric is, the technology isn't right there. If you could put in enough solar arrays, it would be great.
Is it propane out there, or is it?
It's natural gas.
It is.
But to elaborate on that, we would also have to ask ourselves how long it will take for the solar to repay itself. Correct?
Yeah, there's a whole lot of stuff you got to get into. I mean, do you have the real estate to put enough solar in? I mean, that's, this is a huge question. We can talk for hours on it.
Yeah, we already have the entire array there.
Yes, but it's just offsetting the existing use.
Okay.
About the bleachers.
Altos Junior roofing again, as mentioned, they were they did have partial roofing replacements done with federal funding, but they did not have all the roofing replaced. Boilers and fire alarm there as well. Gravity fire alarm roofing throughout as well, and the MPR, the siding, the electronic damage. Again, kind of some of those big numbers on the roofing because they have one very large building that needs an entire roof. Calabasas, we see HVAC, they have 30 rooftop units that need to be replaced, roofing throughout there as well as their office buildings. Saint Charles Middle School, they have doors that need to be replaced on their gym, replacement of a few of their portables, as well as their parking and basketball court need to be repurposed. DTI, Diamond Technology Institute, we have drainage that needs to be done on the hillside, and part of the hill is starting to give away there. We have AC servicing floor drains, and then also the awning cover for the water there. Duncan Holber, HVAC units, fire alarm. Currently, they have a fire alarm that's already tied to their neighboring school, but to actually give them a separate fire alarm, and then upgrade their kinder play structure to ensure that it is more ADA compliant and more inclusive of the
last. That's great. That's so exciting. We need an ADA, as you said, playground for kids with disabilities.
EA Hall Middle School, we have site work. There's flat work needed there, some of their portables, abatement on their flooring, as well as roofing on several of their gates as well. Freedom, there's rot in room 9 that needs to be damaged. We also have repair of their HVAC units as well as roofing throughout that site. HA Hyde, siding their MPR portable replacement as well as the fire alarm. Again, you're kind of seeing those themes as we go through each school, fire alarm, siding, roofing. Hall District Elementary, we have siding for their, for 13 portables, roofing, and fire alarm as well. Lakeview, roofing, MPR, and dry rot on their walkway and everything. So again, their MPR, you've seen their cables and their MPR actually are unusable because of damage. Landmark, where we are now, stucco and dry rot damage, roofing throughout the throughout this site and paint as well. There's a lot of paint that we paint the entire campus after damages are done or addressed. McQuiddy Elementary, we have fire alarm, siding MPR throughout, and roofing throughout with HVAC units as well. So they actually do roofing as well as HVAC. Mar Vista, we have their MPR boiler. The steps at the front of Mar Vista, they're damaged and need to be demoed and replaced. And then also, that site does need security fencing around the entire campus. It really does lack kind of that safety for our students. Minty White Elementary, roofing tiles, replacing portables. They still, even with Measure L funding going towards portable replacements, they still have over 10 aging portables. And then fire alarm, again, moving that voiceover IP system.
President Holman, quick comment question.
You know, what I'm wondering is, can we let Clint get through the presentation so that we can get all the information? Mm-hmm. These slides will be available. We do have a whole hour for discussion afterwards.
When the sign is up, when that's the front of your mind and you can ask specific questions, that's the only thing. Like at the end of the presentation, I'll
can we people make notes if there's a slide if they want to go around to? Would that work?
I like that.
I'll happily go back to any slide. New school, we have erosion on their hillside, restroom plumbing, and then they're building a PR actually using trees. Ohlone has dry pine roof. They have a lot of bumps to their roofs. So again, replacing the energies and everything as well as dry rock areas, fire alarms, and furnaces in their main building. Pajaro Middle, perimeter fencing for that site as well, MPR cables, similar to the tables mentioned before, they really aren't usable in their MPR anymore, and then buffer room renovations. PV High, we have roof damage that needs to be repaired. The K&J rain carpet needs to be removed and reinstalled, and then we dig out one of the sites that is remaining that is still being cut new in formal cast clockwell painting system. Again, this was, as being a newer site, they had a PA system that did not get the newest in formal cast one. Radcliffe, we have foundation vents and concrete. We also have flooring concerns as well as stairs for their two-story portables need to be removed. Renaissance High School, bathroom in their back wing needs to be renovated. Fire alarm again, and then furnace replacements. Rio del Mar Elementary School, their stairs and ramp need to be demoed and replaced. They also have a need for the new fire alarm, and then they also have old inefficient workers. Going to middle school, concrete work as well as fire alarm and their gym bleachers. Starlight Elementary School, roof dry rot gutters, as well as plumbing issues and concrete walkway by their kindergarten area need to be replaced. Valencia Elementary School, we have erosion. They actually need a failing storm grate outlet that needs to be replaced. It's causing an erosion on the hillside. Kitchen and classroom floor maintenance, as well as windows that need to be replaced because this was one of those sites that had those individual windows. Watsonville Charter School of the Arts. Structural upgrades are needed throughout their campus. They have weather, ground, termite damage. They also have a field that has wastewater discharge going into it that needs to be addressed, as well as a fire alarm to break away from all the other buildings that have their own system. In Watsonville High School, they have a large boiler that needs to be removed, abated, most likely, and replaced with a new HVAC system. And then they need to address the two-story stairs in their admin room. And as many of you know, they need to address the bleachers, press box at their Geyser Field. While they do have Measure L funds, it would not cover the entire work needed to do that. So, sorry for the long drum out of each site, but again, I'm happy to go back. Our recommendation, so of the $52.76 million in ESSER funding, we wanted to look at allocating $20 million towards roofing repairs, replacement district-wide. If I add up only the low end of those roofing, it actually ends up over $30 million. But again, trying to look at how can we utilize that money, do you want to address some of the really most dire needed sites in terms of roofing. So $20 million will allow us to really start that work. We would like to set aside another $10 million for other projects identified by facilities. Really the goal is to try and look at some of these priority projects at each site and ensure that we are spending that sort of money on all of our sites. So if we're looking at roofs at some of those major sites, we still want to have money left over to do the site that don't need roofing repairs, but do have other needs to be addressed. And then that leaves us with $22.76 million for student supports, mental health staffing, and academic acceleration, all the way through September 30th, 2024. So again, to kind of bring it back to that expanded learning opportunities grant money that we have, the $15 million that's for this year, we were, for this year, actually able to add a lot of what our community spoke to in those surveys of adding in mental health supports, adding additional staffing, adding, doing things like PVPSA, EAOP for our students to help them with whether it's mental health or academic support. So we actually have put a good amount of money towards those supports for this year, but this would be to continue those in the out year. So again, while we did receive some money in that expanded learning, we haven't really seen money that's for facilities, which is why you see the ask being larger for facilities, because we do have about, again, 15.06 million of expanded learning money that is going to handling that mental health staffing, academic acceleration, all of that. So, with that, I now have questions and discussions.
Thank you, President Hall. Just quickly, you know, thank you for working on the press box in the restrooms. I know that's been an issue that I've been hearing the last year, especially with the multiple high softball girls winning late, and people are wondering what about the press box in the restroom for the girls. So I just wanted to say thank you for that. Thank you for E. Hall. You know, Hall, you answered a lot of the concerns a lot of the constituents have had. Something about mini white. Is there a way, or is it possible to make this the nursing stations bigger? And also to make sure they have hot water. I know ever since I have left mini white, I'm glad to see a lot of teachers here, a lot of nurses, psychologists. The nursing stations are still the same size. And I know with COVID and everything, and how a lot of the teachers are saying a lot of cramped closed quarters. And so if that's something to look into, nursing stations. And also too, I know we were talking a little bit about the Measure L at Watsonville High School, but wasn't some of the Measure L funds supposed to go to fix the science buildings at the high school? Do you know?
Brian, do you happen to know the remaining L funds? I think it's unallocated to Watsonville High, right?
Yes, it's on their priority list.
So that is on their priority list. They have not allocated the remaining Measure L funds in their set funds to determine what they need to do.
I just wanted to bring it up. It's good to see some of these teachers here from Ming White. It's not just me complaining and talking. It's good to hear from the teachers and everybody that's on the ground. So I just wanted to say thank you, everybody, from Ming White and Bradford for coming and helping me out. So, but other than that, thank you very much for all this. It's so the people I've been talking about. So thank you.
I was really glad to hear you address the issue of the ongoing savings. Isn't the one time I knew that was a question I was going to ask about. If at some point it doesn't have to be tonight, I love numbers. When I feel like you just an estimate on like what kind of savings we see ongoing, I would love to get an idea of that. I was also curious about a lot of what I've been hearing in the news is just inflation, kind of skyrocketing right now. And do you also see that as one of the ways in which by investing, some of these one-time fundings now that we're saving on future costs because of the?
Absolutely, that's one of them. It's also being strategic in spending these funds. I'm sure as many of you know, with COVID-19, we've seen a huge increase in the cost of wood, steel. So that's part of it, is trying to adjust some of these projects to kind of balance between inflation and also the lowering cost actually in the out years of those materials. So. But I do see absolutely. I mean, one piece is doing an earlier and saving it versus inflation. Also, just the manpower and the time and energy that's been spent maintaining these buildings. And I know that here in Cruz, spend a lot of time maintaining things that really should be replaced, and then give them time to spend that those hours really maintaining other facilities.
And just for the benefit of the public, I mean, maybe this is obvious to everyone, but it's like you talked about doing the 55 HVAC unit. Like for our average site, like how many HVAC units are there per site? Because we have 33.
It really varies by size.
Right.
School. Every single classroom in the school.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not used to it.
That's okay.
Yeah, it varies a lot by site. Every single classroom in some of our smaller elementary schools has a furnace, so. All of the portable relays have a heat pump, which does heating and cooling. A lot of the admin wings have rooftop mounted HVAC units in the 3 to 5 ton capacity units. The gyms all have rooftop units. But it varies by site. So basically, if you're looking at most of our sites, you're looking at one HVAC unit per classroom.
And so where you can find that information is on our website. You'll, in the COVID, on the COVID page, you are able to see the HVAC inspection. There's a list of every single school and every single classroom and where, whether or not that HVAC was changed out or what they have. So you are able to see that.
Perfect. And also, you know, for slide 38 for Rio Del Mar, it's like those stairs, you know, I've been a Rio parent since 2003. And it's like, I know that I was surprised at the cost of the estimate for those stairs. It was, even being, you know, somewhat familiar with construction projects, I was like, really? So I just want to acknowledge the repair work on those that has been done. That's, you know, I'm really glad that we were able to do that, and hopefully at some point, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. So we did repair work, as you noted, on the stairs at Rio, because really to fix them properly is to actually demolish and rebuild. It's not as simple as just repaving. We did do some work to make them safer and make them you know, make them look better than they did, but absolutely to repair them completely, it's really regrading them. And I know Gary's talking to me at nauseam of what it would require to actually replace them, because it's a lot more than it would seem.
So the last question I have for right now is, you know, in previous meetings and at the town hall last, it was one of them. You know, there are questions about fair distribution of resources and infrastructure funding and all of that. And how do you see this recommendation addressing those concerns?
Yeah, so again, I think it's looking at the priorities by site and really trying to look at what really improves that site most and makes it most safe for our students, and kind of, again, putting health and safety at the forefront. It's very difficult to say that equal is going to be each site gets the same exact dollar amount, but we will try to make it as equitable as possible by addressing those top concerns, or at least a top concern at each site. You can see in the presentation a lot of those dollar amounts vary, because some of our sites, facility-wise, are in better shape than others, but it's really trying to make sure that we look at each project and see that we can do something for all of our schools.
Thank you.
Thank you for all your work. So I know that we've been talking about utilizing funds, not just for facilities, but we're also talking about utilizing those funds for after school programs, enrichments, our additional IAs and teachers. What about technology? I know that PV High School, a lot of our staff needs new computers.
All accepted
with the new computers. Okay, and what about their library? I know that their library needed some computer upgrades, and they were hoping for some furniture and some new Spanish books.
So we will be converting our libraries into learning hubs, so we'll be using our expanded learning opportunity grant money for that. So all of our libraries at the high school level will be upgraded for the learning hubs.
And will that include some new books too?
It will, and new furniture and facilities. So it will be, if you've been in Aptos High, where they actually have what they're called study corrals, where they're behind glass. But so they can engage with each other in a fairly small area, but it's all glass, so we can still see them, but they can, there's a noise barrier,
right.
And new furniture. We also put in that, we put a fab lab at Aptos High, so those types of things will be happening, as well as next week you'll see Myon, which is a digital version, and then we will be doing hard books as well. But we are aiming more towards the 21st century learning environment.
That's good news, because I know I had a lot of questions about that.
And just to expand a little bit, we also have the President Biden did release the Emerging Connectivity Fund, which Dan Lanzer has been working very diligently to get going to all of our students as well as our staff. And you may have seen that survey go out. That's where we're actually able to buy anyone who does not have a computer at home a laptop to be, or a Chromebook to be able to utilize by our time. So we'll actually be able to utilize some of that funding as well to purchase more additional Chromebooks and replace some of our old Chromebooks.
Okay, great, that's good news. So I know also we've looked at, we have hired more social emotional counselors. Do we have plans to make sure that each site has access to a social emotional counselor?
Yeah, so I'll start, and if Chris wants to add on. So we went to a 2-to-1 ratio for elementary. So we were at a 4-to-1 ratio. So now it's a 2-to-1 ratio. We were at a 2-to-1 ratio for middle school. We went to a 1-to-1 ratio. And high school is still at a 1-to-1 ratio, but we added mental health clinicians that are helping to support the high school. And we have also, which you will see next week as well, using expanded learning opportunity monies, we have increased PDPSA contract by about $200,000 to provide additional support. And Chris, take it away. You want to add on?
Not much. You did most of the heavy lifting there. A couple of pieces. We have 3 currently opening and flying. They close this week, so we have interviews going on next week. Part of that was from attrition of some of our folks moving on and then backfilling those positions. At this point, everybody's already kind of assigned to those 2 pieces of their 2 elementary schools, and we were able to keep consistency and care as well. So what that basically means is that our social emotional counselors that were already with us, although they may have had 4 schools, they still have at least 1 of those schools in the mix. So usually the strongest connection and the highest service level or cases that they had at a school, that person remained with that school in addition. So we were able to get kind of that continuity of care in addition to. And again, we have the 3 left openings, good number of applicants, and we definitely have not found a shortage. So each time we've gone out and asked for social emotional counselors, we've been blessed with really having a good stacked deck of folks interested in working in that field. So no reason to believe that we won't have those in place next week when we finish closing.
Okay. Okay. You might want to stay for this question. Have we looked, I know Cesar Chavez Middle School had been looking at a full-time ELS. Have we?
Well, whole time, you know, they were trying to look at combining the position with having it still be a 50% ELS, but also having it be with an ELA or social studies, so they could stay at. Oh, sorry.
And can you also the initial, the public one,
English language specialist?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what I believe what Cesar Chavez was looking at is having their English language specialist position at the 50% and matching it with like an English social studies or whatever the credential person has. So it's not that they were going to have a 1.0 English language specialist, but that they'd have a person at their site as a 1.0 doing both mm-hmm. things. So.
And we're working on that. We haven't felt that. Is that correct?
It is correct. One of the things that we have seen in the past is we have a model that's somewhere at Aptos Junior right now, where the ELS is actually supporting a class in addition. It's actually been an effective model because they're working with similar kids and really are being able to support, but also they know what it feels like as a teacher to continue to be teaching in that capacity. So we do have success in that model. Cesar Chavez is looking at that piece too, to be able to retain the 1.0. They have staffing to be able to do so.
And then the other question I've gotten from parents and staff at Cesar Chavez Middle School is about full-time music teachers or utilizing our partners. I know they have the band, but they don't really have a full-time program, but utilizing maybe one of our partners to get a middle school type program started over there. So that would be something.
I will look into that and be able to respond.
Yeah, so Cesar Chavez has one of our best band teachers. So I'm not really sure what they're referring to because he is he's the one that always plays at our state of the district. And he is there. So
I think
maybe he's not full time because I thought it was full time. So, I think that he goes to the high school.
Yes, so he's full-time with PD and Cesar Chavez. And I would say that is we try to grow those programs at the speed of the kids, right? So if we're getting enough interest in sections filled, then that's what we've done is we started peeling people back and putting them in at a 1.0 at a site that supports it all, and then backfilling like PD high high or whatnot. So we try to grow out the skin of the kids as well. But yeah, it can be 60-40 with PD and
super chat. It seems like there's more interest overall now for music. So that was something I just wanted to check in with our funds that we're doing. And then the only other thing I have is Cesar Chavez has no outdoor shade structure for the kids. And I was a little bit camp parents. And a lot of the kids were sweltering, and we had one little pop-up tent for shade.
And along with all sites, as we did utilizing some of that ESSER fund or some of the in-person instruction money early on, we are building a shade structure at each site. So Cesar Chavez is receiving a shade structure, and they are on the site. So they will be receiving.
Okay, thank you.
Can you talk more about the schedule on that? Because we thought some of that work was going to be started already in June, and I have not seen evidence of that, so can you tell us about some of the scheduling?
Absolutely, I'm not informed by me out here. I'll speak briefly. Ryan can give you some more details on the exact scheduling. We have been working diligently with the three different companies that we did contract with to build the shade structures. I know that one of the companies was having difficulties acquiring the actual material, but they are going to start doing the actual groundwork to have it prepped. So as soon as the material can come in, they will be able to just attach it. And I believe that's next week. If Ryan can probably speak to some of the timelines on that, so I'll let you speak to that.
Good evening, everyone. Good to see you all in person. Yeah, just like Clint was saying, is a lot of them got delayed with material treatment, specifically the piers themselves. We have, as of today, we have 8 different sites where they're pouring concrete. I think one of them is Cesar Chavez. So there'll be sections of 8 with each manufacturer, and the last ones to be done are the 2 high schools, and that's looking, it'll be a little bit into the school semester, but it'll be all temp fencing, it'll be a very small footprint, but that's where we stand right now.
Thank you. That's great to know. And the only other thing I'd like to say is that I agree that we need to put money towards facilities, because as we know just from the presentation, there's a lot of concerns about our facilities, and some of the things that you have mentioned here are from sites also. So I think that looking at putting that $20 million for roofing and repairs, and then also what things need to be really done at site. We have some stairs issues at some sites that really need to be handled also. Thank you.
Of course.
Anyone else?
I just like to follow up with Trustee Shopkins' comments. From all the issues you were explaining, some of the same issues that I dealt with when I was employed here, and it's good to see that they're getting addressed, because these are things that have been in existence prior to me being here, prior to these gentlemen as well, and finally bringing the school or the schools and the facilities into a newer age and more improving. So it's good to see that this is finally happening. But thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so, quick question. I've gotten a couple questions regarding the stairs. At Wassamo High, are the stairs really needed on the Mellow Center? Is the Mellow Center relatively new? That's all stairs at Wassamo High.
Oh, it's
I just read about it.
I
was talking about
there. It's in their admin building. And again, it's replaced. Ryan, you're welcome to speak to it. Exactly where those locations are.
Is it the admin building development? Well, that's the outside line.
It's in the admin center, going to the second story.
Yeah.
Both of those sets of stairs are actually rusting out from below. Uh-huh. There's poor drainage in them, so if we don't address them now, we're going to have big holes in our stairs.
Oh, you know, it's just, I mean, people think of stairs, but they don't want to see them.
Yeah.
This is on the interior of it, correct?
No, this is on the exterior.
Oh, on the exterior.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
I do.
Yes. So, on the PUSD District 1 facilities priorities, under Priority 31, Virtual Academy, there is a listing for additional portables, removing the old portables at Wattsville High School, replacing them with 3 manufactured portables. And I'm wondering where those portables will be placed.
I know that there's other schools across the district that could benefit from an additional portable to have a library in place, for example, at Wixa. I know Duncan Colbert is going to get a portable soon, so we're very excited about that. But can you speak to that item, please?
Yeah, that already gives a brief that was something we spoke about in looking at the need for virtual academy.
So one of the changes that was made at the state level was the requirements to independent study. So in order for virtual academy to stay compliant, they have to now provide synchronous time. So that means that they have to now have some facilities that they apply that. And so there are several portables if you're looking at the field and you're at the M&O lot, and then you're looking at the field, the Watsonville High field, then they're the first set of two portables. So they have two portables there. If you go to the portables right behind there, they're actually currently condemned portables. So they have tarps over them, over the roof, and people are not currently using them. So the thought is to take those away because they're not currently being used, and then place in new portables so they can do the synchronous learning that they're now required to do. So the question will come up of, well, can't they provide the synchronous learning through virtual? And they can, and they will. But there has to be a portion of that where students are able to physically come in person. So you will have large groups, but we do need to provide them a physical space. If we don't do that, then what will happen is they will have to find space at a school site, and that is not an easy thing to do. And so again, it's going back to what can we do to ensure that our programs can even run? And if we don't address virtual academy, which is going to have about 300 students, they won't have a place to be at.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that clarification. I just didn't see it as part of the...
Yeah,
it was there like right before I came into my chat because we left off, but it's okay. It went somewhere.
Is that something we can use our, what's our funds that are for the, that we use for the
developer fees?
Thank you.
We can also use developer fees. We just, again, we're trying to use this funding strategically because this has a time limit versus our developer fees not have much.
Well, I'm just thinking maybe we can get stairs done somewhere if we use developer fees for the portables. Sorry, Marie.
No, it's fine. And the other thing I'm excited about is Duncan Homer improvements. For a while, I've been raising ADA concerns, whether it's at the playground or inside the facility. So I'm really happy to see that we're not only providing them with additional portables, but also that we're addressing their concerns on the playground. So I think that's going to not only benefit kids, but I think staff overall. That school. And then going back to the concern raised regarding the space for health offices, is that something that we can explore from maybe potential savings? Trustee Holm, President Holm said that, you know, that we will be seeing some ongoing funding, savings from the renovations that we're going to be moving forward with. So could those savings could potentially be allocated to explore doing something with?
Yes, I'll start and let Dr. Rodriguez continue. Part of the problem will be a lot of the ongoing savings will be either long-term savings or it'll be really staff time, right? So we'll see savings in staff time, which will allow us to address other issues and make sure that we don't have as many concerns going forward. I don't know when we'll see the actual return on investment in some of the projects. So if the health offices are a concern that are more immediate, I might want to say we look at utilizing the savings. So I think savings will be more long-term, but I'll let that be something on the top.
Yeah, so to prepare for return to in-person, what we did is we had each school site, the health clerk and the district, the COVID nurse, they looked at a location. So in most cases, or a lot of cases, that health office was moved to a different location so that it can be bigger. Because almost all of the health offices prior were tiny, and so they couldn't really provide the isolation needs. What I would say is we can look at structures. Some schools, for instance, Radcliffe, we are having the challenge of even figuring out where we're going to put all the kindergartners. So it's not as easy as let's find a better location, because in some cases we're still very strapped for space. We're not as strapped for space as we used to be, not for a good reason, but because of declining enrollment, we are better. However, for example, we're adding an intervention teacher at each elementary school. They won't necessarily always get their own classroom, because there isn't always their own classroom available. So I think what we did have, and she did a wonderful job, April and Mike, she retired, and so now we have a set of fresh eyes with our COVID nurse, and so we can continue to have those conversations. But in terms of some settings, I mean, Radcliffe in particular, I went out myself because there was a concern of where it was placed. And we really couldn't find another location because we needed that space for classrooms. But we can look at different barriers. As for the hot water, most of our sites do not have hot water. Most school sites do not have hot water. And it's for so that children can't get scalded and all that. Of course, we do have hot water in the kitchen because that's a health code requirement. But most schools don't actually have hot water for that reason. In terms of portable sinks, just so you know, I mean, we've looked at all avenues, portable sinks. We had a lot of conversation around that, and there was a lot of concerns with the health element of the portable sinks, how often it was going to be cleaned out, how often it would be disinfected, who would be doing the transference of that water. Just the staleness of the water, because it's not like it's coming running from a pipe. So, but we're open to definitely having those conversations, but it's been pretty significant conversation around it. And we'll keep moving it forward.
Thank you for that. Clint, what's the likelihood that we would end up closer to the lower end as we budgeted for versus the higher end?
So again, the median we went with was about that $93 million. So I would say, being safe, it's going to be somewhere in the middle. Some projects may fall on that low end. Some are going to fall on that high end. So typically, you budget about in the middle. So again, the $93 million is utilizing that median. So that's not even necessarily worst case scenario. That's kind of being hopeful that some projects will come in lower. But again, I would say the likelihood is that most of those projects will fall somewhere between those two.
And then the last thing that I think is more of a statement, maybe Michelle, you can have some, feel free to chime in. You know, there were some concerns brought up tonight regarding parent involvement and reaching out to the community. I don't think we've done this much outreach in the past. At least when I first came to office back in 2012, we weren't really reaching out to the larger community, our parent community, as much as we should. So just for the public to know, that has increased, am I correct, drastically, and there's different avenues.
Yeah, I mean, we started doing town halls and conversations with the superintendent only about 2 years ago. We are just started the thought exchange, which has been really significant. Since I've got there, almost 5 years now, I do meet monthly with our parent leadership groups. So I do that. And we did, and I should have noted, we also did have our parent engagement network did hold several meetings with our families as well. So I think the beauty of it is that we try to really expand the number of people who are doing outreach. Again, we're seeing common themes. So what that tells me is that we're reaching out quite a bit. I do want to note, because it wasn't in the newspaper, that we actually had more participation from our Spanish-speaking parents than we did our English-speaking parents. So we only had 7 English-speaking parents or community members that were there, but we had 22 Spanish-speaking parents. And so that's due to the fact that our parent engagement network is really trying to support. And now every parent receives a text with links. So what that does is it no longer requires me to be able to get online, but all I have to do is have my phone connected and I could take the survey. We also, media outlets are supporting us much more than they ever have. So we do have a pretty large, we're in the newspaper almost every day for something. That is due to us reaching out to local media. And trying to get people to respond. Obviously, June and July are hard times to get people to respond. So I actually think, I think it's at 714 now. 714 responses isn't bad.
And just to expand a little bit on that, this also was not our timeline exactly. CDE sets the timelines for when we need to have certain allocation or certain paperwork done for them. We had to do our assurances by the end of June, and they basically turned around and said, within a month, we want you to start up your plan and have a plan to go to board. So a lot of districts actually were not as lucky as us. We had already planned to do a special board meeting. A lot of CEOs I spoke with said, how are you managing this? I said, well, we're doing a special board meeting. They're like, how did you get one so quick? I said, well, we're lucky that we actually have our board already preemptively looking at how to spend these ESSER funds. So when CDE came out, I think they came out like June 6th and said, by the way, all these ESSER funds you're receiving for ESSER 3, you have to have a plan, you have to do this. And they really kind of throw it at us at the last minute. So we're also not always in control of when we're going to put a survey out, because a lot of times we're out the road with the CDE.
I do want to talk about water quality issues, because we've got some issues, right? And logging, we've got issues with Renaissance. I don't see any of that in this presentation. Do we have any ideas about what we're doing about the water quality issues?
So I can speak to Renaissance. We've actually been working with the water board at Renaissance. They actually, through their organization, are able to assist us with changing the well for free rather than us spending any money, so that's why you don't see them here. Alone, we have not reached out yet, but Renaissance, we are working with a third party to evaluate that and then be able to do changes to that.
So I thought we had drilled a new well and the water quality still wasn't good. So are we drilling deeper into a deeper water table, or what
do we do? I'm not very specific. We worked with our old energy manager who actually kind of oversaw that project. They got dropped for a bit because we were working on getting a new third party, and now that we have one, we've started back up. So I'll let Gary speak with us, but we're doing it at Renaissance.
You know, what we're actually doing at Renaissance is we're working with a technical expert who's helping us to connect up with SoCal Creek Watership. So we're going
to
connect the city water at Renaissance.
Okay.
I don't know the timeline for you yet. It's just in its infancy. We just started it. Our first meeting was last month, or two months ago. But that's what we're doing.
That sounds great. Well, we do have, as you guys remember, some very significant water issues at Ohlone that we're still dealing with. I know we have the hydration stations in there, but they need to get a bit better fix than that. So
I don't want to speak to Ohlone right now because I'm not that up on it yet. 100%
of the
issues,
I'm
sorry about that.
Okay, so the superintendent can fill you in.
I'm sure there are a lot of people
who can fill me in. Yeah, so Ohlone technically is well below the required limits. We did, as a concession, we did put in the hydration stations. However, when you look at the limits, it's actually well below the limits that are the cause or alarm limits. We put in the hydration stations because there was significant concerns in terms of that. Now we have put hydration stations at all of our school sites. Because you guys approved that using some of the care back money. But yeah, technically when we look at their water, it is within, well below the site level requirements. So, we probably wouldn't be using that forward at this time. When the requirements do change, the state will provide funding to support those.
I mean, at Bologna, you did put in reverse osmosis.
We put in reverse osmosis in order to be able to and further soothe concerns.
That's great.
Okay. This is maybe off topic, but I didn't see this up there either, but this is Measure L. I'm wondering about the Performance Arts Center at PV High. I know that's a project that we still need to complete, get started even, get the permits and everything. And can I just get a quick update on where we are with that?
Yeah.
Because this goes to people's mental health, right? Because we've got students, I'm not super convinced that adding a bunch of extra staff is going to soothe mental health issues. What does, to me, what soothes mental health issues is getting kids involved in things that they feel inspired by. So whether that means sports, sciences, hands-on things, performance arts, band, singing, drama, all of those things I think are super, super important. I would really like to see that project get finished.
So just really quickly, we did, I'll talk about the project in a second. We did, in order to ensure that they still could have those programs and have the hearing health of the children, we did construct a double wide portable that has all the acoustics so that they could in fact have all the programs that they wanted. It is the same for sure. As you all saw from the change orders and because of the delay, we did, the field did cost us more than we had originally planned, right? Also, as the gentlemen have been saying, the price of construction continues to skyrocket over time. So we didn't add that here because it probably would need to be included in the next bond.
But there's still money, millions of dollars sitting there.
There is, but an estimated, it's, Ryan, can you come up and say what the new...
This is Ryan's favorite topic, the Sun, Moon, Hose, and PV High.
It's the facetious, it's
not So we did some estimates, I believe it was 2019, when we had Cummings on board, and they are an estimating contractor as well. It was close to what we had it designed out for, a full performance art center. It was close to $20 million at that time, and that was before prices skyrocketed. So we can look into that as far as counting the costs again now and get that to you guys.
Yeah, I know the costs of lumber has gone crazy, but then it's back down again. So there's some costs I think that are back down. I mean, I'd still love to put it out to bid. I mean, I know it's so too early to do that, but you know.
We have $20 million.
Yeah.
How much do we have in the account so for Measure up on that project?
Remaining at PDI?
Yeah.
I believe it's $200,000.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What about the money that was set aside for the performance arts center?
It went to the field. Yes, but when we originally went out for the bond, that's when we had money allocated. So that was 10 years ago. And then we just finished the project about a year ago. So even those prices were about the same.
Yeah.
That makes sense. That is my favorite topic.
and just to clarify too, Ryan, you can correct me if I'm wrong, I believe when we did bid out or originally looked at that performing arts center, I don't think it was anywhere near $20 million in their bond, right? It was much lower too. So even the original estimate for that performing arts center was much lower than actually what it come out.
Okay.
Trustee Conserva, did you have any other questions?
Yeah, thank you. I'm lobbying over here. So all over the district, I think one of the biggest needs at every site is asphalt, like repairing and replacing asphalt and painting, you know, 2 square and 4 square and everything else. And fields, right? Those are two big needs that we have in our district, and I don't see any of that up there. And at this junior high, you know, we wanted to sort of do something with the multi-purpose room and the fields and the track, and I don't see that up there. So anyway, I do think we should expand our music programs. This is kind of something I'll suggest in shock or should. We need to expand them down into 5th and 6th grade so that we have a pipeline to keep kids into band in 7th and 8th and then in high school. We've been hoping to do that, but we would love to see some of this money go towards something like that.
Yeah, so remember on that we have the Safe and Music, which is limiting. So we're on track. We're doing that in a staggered approach. So we'll have 5 schools next year, and we keep adding schools. So by the end, every child will have 45 minutes worth of music instruction, starting in kindergarten, going up to 5th grade. And so that is in the works. And we're using district funding, general fund for that. And I would encourage us to continue to use general fund for that because this is one-time money, and we don't want to ensure an ongoing program is only being funded with one-time monies in order to keep it going. So we have a grant, the Save the Music grant, but we're also putting in district funding. So by 2023, we will have every child will have in elementary school 45 minutes worth of music instruction every week.
And just to speak briefly on Atos Junior, just because I know Ryan probably came in like, hey, he didn't mention it. They are using Measure L funds to improve their NPR, so that project's actually ongoing right now. So that's why you wouldn't see the NPR here, because they are using some of their Measure L funds. I actually know this right in the meeting today about it. So.
Okay.
Fortuitous.
Great, and I'm really glad Bradley's going to have a new roof. So thank you. That's it.
President Hall?
Go ahead.
Since Ryan likes to talk about Measure L funds, and I have a couple of lots of city council members live in my trustee area, do we have an update on EA Hall? If that's okay to ask.
Are you talking about the field in particular? They're starting probably next week. So we have everything all lined up for that. It's going to be a brand new field. So a lot of site work. You're going to see a lot of big tractors out there in the next 2 weeks.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Clint. I just wanted to elaborate, if you could elaborate quickly with all of us, as well as the public, the difference between ESSER funds and the CARES Act funds that we receive.
Yeah, absolutely. So we received a few different funding pots. ESSER funding is really allocated more towards improvements of the school or additional staffing for students kind of post-COVID, especially ESSER 2 and 3, whereas the CARES Act funding was really to address COVID and the learning loss that was going to be happening for students during the pandemic. So a lot of what you saw CARES utilized for was more technology, PPE, cleaning, disinfecting, because it was really when the virus was hitting us hard and we were reacting to the virus being prevalent everywhere. ESSER funding is more utilized now for the after effects. So what do we do to address learning loss in students? What do we do to address the social emotional needs, those types of things? And facilities as well, absolutely, yeah. Health and safety is one of the main components of ESSER funding.
Okay. And the ESSER 3 versus the ESSER 2, the ESSER 3 seems to be more stringent, is that correct?
ESSER 3 is a little bit more stringent. They're very similar. ESSER 3 does have a little bit of extra language in their restricted holdings, but ultimately both are restricted funding with very clear guidelines.
Okay, earlier, and also commented on the name by Trustee Silva with regards to social and emotional counseling. hiring a social emotional counselor, the hope is to keep those employees, although there's no guarantee to keep those employees. So we're able to hire those employees and pay their salaries through ESSER funds, but we're not allowed to utilize ESSER funds towards salaries for current and continuing employees, for raises, for bonuses, etc.
Correct. ESSER 3 specifically actually winded out in their assurances that no dollar of ESSER funding will be utilized to provide a one-time bonus or increase the salary unless it is directly related to a closure due to COVID. So the way they interpreted it was, if you have a site that closes and you can no longer employ those employees because you don't have a site, they would allow that to pay their salaries. They seem to not have to be
able to employ back.
To have employees, if we were to say have a site closed and we didn't have any need for staffing on that site, to be able to continue salaries because it was a major impact of COVID, but not to provide just a one-time bonus, correct? ESSER 3 has one to come out.
But for the social emotional counselors and nurses, we're able to use ESSER funds to hire those employees to pay them, but only with consideration of a temporary basis.
So again, ESSER doesn't look at it as a temporary basis, but we do because we don't want, again, they are one-time funds. But yes, absolutely, ESSER is allowed to hire additional staff because they see that as additional supports for students.
Additional, yeah. So that's clarifying.
Similar to how they expanded learning, it's looking at what are you doing above and beyond what you can do in enrollment.
Okay, I really appreciate the collaboration, not just for us, but also hopefully for the public as well. Back to the previous instance that I
see. Of course.
Go ahead and speak through the next. I did appreciate the equity components in that previous presentation, particularly with our low income students, which we know we particularly have a high percentage of, particularly here in the South County, where a majority of our school district lies down here in the South County, and our ESL students. So I'm really appreciative and supportive of seeing there was some mention about the HVAC systems too, and so money that has already spent, so was some of that was spent through the CARES fund, or that been sent to the
No, it's CARES fund.
Some of that was spent through CARES.
Absolutely. So the slide I showed was all things we use CARES funding for. So we did HVAC.
Okay, but also some of what we see tonight, this isn't just It's not just a presentation saying you're bringing this to the board for approval, but this, some of this has already been spent and allocated that is going to be spent in certain areas, correct? With regards to the ESSER, not CARES Act.
We haven't allocated the ESSER 2 and 3.
It has not been. But there's not going to be a vote on it.
Tonight we are asking for the board to approve the staff recommendation so that we can continue to move some of this work forward. So if we want to do, for instance, some of the routine and replacements in the project, then the quicker we do so, kind of knowing how the escalation, then the better for us. We do have to bring back a comprehensive plan in a few months. And so there will be a second vote. But we do want staff to receive direction on this because we need to get the ball moving in this direction so that we can use it.
But some money has already been spent on the CARES fund on HVAC systems.
So CARES, yeah. So CARES originally was the bucket of money that needed to be spent by December 30th of 2020. We spent it like we were supposed to. Many school districts did not spend it, so they actually extended the window to June 30th of 2021 so that school districts didn't lose it out. We actually were hoping that they would swipe the money and then reallocate because that's what we had originally been told would happen. We spent the money as was originally required, which was December 30th of 2020 was when the deadline to use the CARES Act money. So some of the things when we're talking about what we've done has been from three other pots of money. So we had the CARES Act money that we brought forward and talked about with the HVAC and all the work that we've done. the state, and then we had the in-person, which was a little over $3 million. That's what we spent on, like, the shade structures and additional supplies for students. And then we had the extended learning opportunity grant money, which was a large pot that we've been talking about, that we're suggesting that they continue with the with that plan for multiple years in the future using ESSER. But we actually have not used ESSER 2 or 3 months at this time.
And I'm sorry, my question's going back and forth between both presentations a little bit, but I said I had a question with regards to the survey, and I think the town hall, two separate things, right? There was a survey, and there was also the town hall. The town hall is the one where I think you said there was... I think the town hall is where you cited about having 29 people in attendance.
So there were 7 community parents in element in English, and then we had 22 in the Spanish section.
But that was not the result of the survey. The survey had
survey was above and beyond.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. And did you have the stats from the survey about the percentages of what populations reported how?
That was in his one of his slides. Yeah.
Sorry, I have to switch slides.
Yeah, so that was the one where if the survey was the majority of it was, if I'm just reading off the top of my head, or who's speaking? The majority of it was parents and students, and then we had a small piece that was community members, and then we had another, it was 200 and some, that were staff members.
Just go ahead and click on slide 2. I'll get to it.
So we don't have the demographics of the 309 parents or students on that.
Of which way? Of their language? Of the language that they speak or their site?
All of them.
We actually have it. It's within the data information.
Okay.
Yeah. So we can provide it in the weekly update for you.
Okay. Thank you for that. So then my last one was about for the high-low estimates. I know that that has already been spoken to briefly, right? And you've elaborated a bit on that, and I understand where you're coming with that. But my question is, if we're sort of shot out of the water over these funds, where is the money going to come from?
So again, that's why, so just to speak quickly to the low and high estimates, part of the reason we saw that is these were based on other projects that have been done, our team had with it. We did not pay any architects to come out and actually price out a project. So we really didn't want to spend any money up front to be able to get, you know, the pricing on it down to the fee. The idea would be to spend, again, $20 million on routes to kind of look at how we allocate that out, working with our facilities team to say, okay, this project we think is going to be around $1 million, let's start it, see what we can do with it, and then still trying to balance that out between the other side. So the idea would be not to spend, overspend past that $20 million. It would be what can we do within that $20 million.
So I guess how are you going to pick and choose between all the sites that you showed us and the money that needed, because if you're going to be shut out of the water and over, and if you're not going to, I guess, I would say, Captain or General Fund would be the only place you would go. I don't know where would you go for the money. I mean, how are you going to pick and choose from that litter?
So I think one of the pieces we would do is look at those, some of those sites, that's for full roofing replacements. So we may look at the site and say a full roofing replacement, we estimate between $2 and $4 million. We will do this roof to start because we know that project's maybe around $200,000. and that gets that site down one roof then, and they go through site cases like that. Ryan, unless you have any other thoughts of how we would do it, that's kind of the plan though, is to not necessarily do a full roofing replacement at every site, but to look at doing it piecemeal so that we do ensure that the $20 million gets distributed evenly or equitably.
And I would just go to severity of problems. So for example, they talked about how they went through work orders and they saw where we had constant reports. So I'm totally making this piece up. But let's say it was Calabasas, that when they went in there, they saw, we go back to Calabasas about 10 times every winter. They are one of the sites that was a roofie. We're gonna start with Calabasas. Right, so we would obviously just be safe. So let's say that we have the $20 million. We would probably do what we estimate is $15 million worth of projects. Make sure we can finish those $15 million, and if we have extra, then we would do more roofs. Right, but we'll always start with what's the most severe. So remember, so we are not talking about equality here, right? So what we are talking about is equity in that, what is it something that every site should deserve, which is a non-leaky roof. So we would go to those sites where it's not about North Zone, South Zone, it's really about severity of those concerns. Because if you go, and I guess it's still not working, but if you go to why we chose those priorities, it would be off of that list. So what's gonna save us money? What's gonna save us time? What's gonna save us, people grief, health issues? So we have people, when we do have roof issues, worry about mold, worry about, respiratory infections. And so we would start with that, and then we move forward. What I will say, and I just want to make sure to say, because I want to manage expectations a bit, is remember what they said was there was $90 million worth of repairs in all that listing. Yeah. So no, all those projects will not be done. So when you later on hear, well, we didn't get this done, why not? It's because we can't, even if we wanted to, we couldn't do all those projects. And so we can definitely allocate more towards facilities if we wanted to, but we wanted it because it was the number one request, and we heard it today as well, that mental health and the health and safety of students is the community's number one priority, and it has been staff's number one priority. So if we don't maintain that $22 million for whether it is that we decide, yes, we're going to do more nurses, yes, we're going to do more school psychologists, whatever it is, we need funding to be able to do that, and we need funding to continue what we've already began to implement with the expanded money opportunities grant.
And these would be our place.
Yeah.
All of them are our place. Even if it's temporary.
Yeah, I mean, the goal is to see what we can do. I mean, we are hearing that we're going to continue to receive more ongoing funding, so hopefully we can fold that staff into the budget, and we don't have to just have them until 2024, right? The goal is to continue that support.
And also, just, I guess, to FYI, faculty and staff, because of the timing of this getting approved and going out to bid, some of these construction projects will be happening during the school year. It's not going to be that they will be done before students return, just for clear understanding.
Oh, yeah, I mean, this will only happen in 2 weeks, yeah.
Yeah.
I guess. If I can make it happen, that would be
great. I'm very Harrison and Damien, yes. Okay, thank you. And the equity component, I mean, I know probably everyone in this room knows how major of an issue this is in the public K-12, PK-12 educational system, not just here in the state, nationwide. So anything that we, as one of the leading and largest school districts in the state of California, can do to be a leader in that and set an example going forward, I'm all in appreciative of that. So thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. No further comments, I will entertain a motion.
I will to approve.
A second.
First and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. I will adjourn our meeting.
I did get it, but you're going to be reporting out of closed session, correct?
Yeah. Yes.
And it's not on the agenda. Do you realize that? There's nothing on the agenda that says report out of closed session, so it can't be reported out of closed session tonight. That's right.
Can we?
I'd like to make a motion to.
Can I make a motion to abandon the agenda?
After it's already been approved?
I believe because we did have closed session on the original agenda, we did neglect to put out a report out of closed session, but it's just reporting out what we actually did. I feel pretty confident that we can report out of closed session. Now, if we had not put closed session on the agenda, I agree with you that we wouldn't be able to just add that, but we did have closed session on the agenda.
So do we need a further motion? Or
I would agree we need to amend the approval of the agenda, yes.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion to amend the approval of the agenda to include the readout of our closed session business.
I'll second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you for that clarification. Okay, please report on item
2.1.
Thank you.
So, closed session item 2.1. I move to approve the certificated personnel report as presented by district administration on July 1st, 2021, with 25 and 17 additional action items.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
Closed session item 2.2, I move to approve classified personnel report as presented by district administration on July 21st, 2021 with 15 and 7 additional action items.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
And I do have some announcements to make. So, announcement one, the Pajaro Valley Unified School District is pleased to announce the selection of Marina Aldonado as the new coordinator of site extended learning serving the Quiddy and Hyde Elementary School. Marina has been serving students since 2008 as an elementary teacher, after school coordinator, summer school principal, and most recently as the technology coach and Dream Lab director for Radcliffe and Amsterdam. While attending the University of California at Santa Cruz, Mrs. Maldonado obtained a Bachelor of Arts degree in Sociology, as well as a Master's in Education and her multiple subject teaching credential. She obtained her Administrative Services credential via the California Preliminary Administrative Credential Examination. Mrs. Maldonado brings her 13 plus years of experience in elementary as coordinator and tech coach roles to both McQuitty and H.A. Hyde Elementary Schools. These experiences will serve her well in her new position. We are proud to welcome this highly accomplished educator to her new administrative role. Announcement two, Nevaeh Padilla. The Pajaro Valley Unified School District is pleased to announce the selection of Nevaeh Padilla as the new assistant principal of Pajaro Valley High School. Nevaeh has been serving students since 2002 as both a teacher and administrator. She has served as the assistant principal at Pajaro Middle School for the last 8 years. She obtained her Bachelor of Arts in History from the University of Santa Cruz, as well as a Master's in Education and her teaching credential. While attending San Jose State, she earned her Master's in Educational Leadership and an Administrative credential. Mrs. Padilla brings her almost 20 years of experience in elementary, middle school, high school, and assistant principal roles at Pajaro Valley High. These experiences will serve her well in her new position. We are proud to welcome this highly accomplished educator to her new administrative role. The Pajaro Valley Unified School District is pleased to announce the selection of Chrissy McLean as the new coordinator of academic and social emotional counseling programs. Chrissy has been serving students since 2011 as a secondary teacher, technology integration coach, and most recently as the assistant principal in charge of master scheduling at Watsonville High School. While attending the University of California at Santa Cruz, Mrs. McLean attained a Bachelor of Arts degree in American Studies, as well as a Master's in Education and her single subject teaching credential. She also obtained her Administrative Services credential. Mrs. McLean has been awarded the Santa Cruz County Administrator of the Year, as well as the State Educator of the Year for Region 5. Her 11 plus years of experience will serve her well in this new position.
We are proud to welcome this highly accomplished educator to her new administrative role. And last, on behalf of our superintendent and district administration, we are pleased to announce Simona Ariala's promotion to supervisor of transportation. Mrs. Ariala has worked for the Pajaro Valley Unified School District since 2001 and brings a wealth of knowledge and experience working as a school bus driver for the transportation department. She works actively to support the goals and objectives of the department. Their district-wide knowledge and understanding of the students we transport to school each day are invaluable. She is skilled at listening, having productive and open conversations, and puts students at the forefront of decisions made that will move the transportation department into the future. We are proud to promote her to our supervisor of transportation. She looks forward to serving the district and continuing the good work of making sure students are transported to school safely every day.
Thank you. All right, so I'll see you all at our next regular board session next Wednesday, July 28th. And with that, I will adjourn the meeting at 8:53. Thank you all.
Thanks, Hannah.